Hey, it's me again, and this time we are at my personal OX build, which is actually for sale. I guess it is relevant for Israeli residents only, but anyway, let me tell you all about it. Remember the video I've uploaded a long time ago about putting a 200 amps controller on my OX? Yeah, that happened eventually. I was planning on shorter periods between the videos, but you know, life and shit. But it's for the best, to be honest, because I wasn't sure about this setup for a long time, but now I can definitely tell you this is a reliable one. Even though I got my motor rewinded, I wasn't sure it'll handle the high current of my controller, which is at 110 amps battery and 150 phase amps, fitted by 25R cells, 60 volts, 27.5 amps hour battery. The motor was getting pretty hot. After a few months of testing it, I've realized this motor cannot be killed. As I mentioned before, it's rewinded, means I got more phase cables in it, but I lost a bit of a torque at the beginning due to that, because the only way I could achieve more phase cables volume is to wire it for higher RPM, so it was either that or nothing. The difference is nothing crazy, but I can definitely feel it. Stock motor had much more torque, but it could burst in flames any second due to too much current flowing through it. With higher RPM, my mid-range speed is now not overheating the motor. Another solution for the heat was covering the motor with high temperature resistant varnish, which helps me with distributing the heat evenly over the stator and reducing the risk of one of the phases to overheat at certain locations on the stator. On top of that all, I got some ferrofluid in, which transfers the stator heat faster to the outer shell, which also cools faster than usual due to drilled holes for the ventilation. I got them on the both sides. The last weak link that was fixed is the stock motor cable, which could be a bottleneck for the whole setup. I fixed it by using 12 gauge silicon cables, stripped out of its thick insulation, and used the thin heat shrink tubes to be able to squeeze them all into the same, not enlarged, axle shaft. The job wasn't easy at all, but it was completed eventually. One last thing that was done in it is a temperature sensor, which is wired to my controller to throttle down the output once the temps reach 110 degrees Celsius. After a long time of testing, this happened only once. Considering Israeli summer, which could reach 42 degrees in the summer, this is quite an achievement. Once I got the mechanical and electrical parts working without any risks, I started with the design. The thing I really like about the scooter is that it allows you to go wild with your imagination. It's a very customizable scooter. I chose a stock color theme this time to kind of respect the origins, but also make it my own way. Rear fender painted in bright orange and Poseidon blue colors by Montana, as the rest of the rig of course, being held by my custom made fender mount, which is a must if you are into zero noise while riding. This thing holds the fender in place no matter how you ride. Curb drops, potholes, bad roads, the fender will not move as it was with a stock plastic one. In the same area we have house favorite, Hope Tech 2 brakes, 2 pistons, I didn't overkill it this time with 4s, and it works perfectly. The controller is mounted into this box, which I went with a different approach. I didn't want to make it anything similar to a stock triangle box, so I came up with this. Some like it, some not, but I am all in with it. Ventilation holes are made after the first try as my controller was overheating in there. Few examples were made as I broke one by mistake and had some coloring changes in my mind. But the final product came out perfect. The awesome part in it is that it is so fun to work with. Once the controller is inside, all its cables are hanging from down below, and it makes the assembly headache free. Most of the rigs has its controllers inside the scooter body, and when it's a tight fit, it is always annoying and scary to screw in the deck, being afraid of something being pinched, stretched, or disconnected somewhere in between the two. But in my case, all the cables are roaming free with all the space left inside. Now, you might call me weird or crazy, but I really like my scoots with minimal accessories. Only the essentials is my way to go. Handlebars, phone mount for the trips to the areas I'm not familiar with, and yes, there is no display and not even a vault display either. Ask me why? That's because I am so familiar with its range capabilities that I don't really need this. It might be a little extreme of a thought, but I say it is less things to have trouble with. I use it mostly for work to home route, and I'm not even reaching its range limits, which should be about 60 km riding at 50 km per hour. I know I definitely have the 35 to 40 km range while going crazy on the throttle. If I got plans to go further, I just go easier on it. By the way, cool tip about throttle position. Notice that the throttle lever is lower than usual, and the throttle cable is on top of the brake lever. Why is that? Imagine yourself that something wrong happened while you ride and you lost your control of your handlebars. If you have your throttle lever at its higher position, it is very easy to slip off the handlebars, because one or two of your fingers are at the brake lever, so your only grip thrust is in your two or three fingers left holding it. Your thumb won't help you because it's already above the handlebars, it'll just fly forward. But if your throttle lever is at the lowest position, if shit goes wrong, your palm would want to slide forward, but your thumb is in the way, grabbing the handlebars from the bottom, effectively preventing your palm from moving further. I did not just invent this in my thoughts, I literally fell off my scooter once due to wet handlebars in the winter, and I could have easily prevented that by having my thumb at its lower grip point and not resting on top of the throttle, waiting to slide. One last thing in here is the headlight button and the stealth controller on and off button designed as horn. Short push won't do a thing, but a bit longer will turn on and off the controller. Headlight button is just about to be wired to its one and only Supernova M99 headlight. I just removed it for its better mounting solution. If you're using this headlight, don't be an asshole and mount it at the highest position, as you would blind everybody on the road. I think it's stupid to have a 450 euro headlight and not use its perfectly horizontally aligned beam. The only reason it's off, it is because when it's mounted at the lower point of the stamp hole, sometimes the daylight sensor on it is activated by the car's headlight behind you, which is now solved with the new mount that covers it to have a constant nighttime light. The last part of this build, and probably the most charismatic, is the custom-made wooden deck, which also had to be done twice due to painting fails. I covered it with the cardboard pieces to ensure the lucky buyer will have it as brand new. It also has my iconic screw and bolt grip idea, which I made on my previous purple ox. Nothing beats the feeling of this grip. To be honest, I don't get people riding on acrylic-made decks which seem to be slippery as fuck once a single drop of anything is on it. The price is 17,000 shekels, which is $5,200. Foreign followers might think this is nuts, but these are the prices these rigs are sold locally, especially with all the investments in it. Do not forget, we live in Tel Aviv, the center of Israel, which is also expensive as fuck. To understand the local prices, the battery alone cost me about 1,800. I guess I am done covering this one. Hope you all like it. I was Sub 13. Peace.